Hello, I'm Mike Montague, and this is Who Moves You, the podcast about real estate and the real estate market in Central and South Central Ontario. One thing real estate agents do differently, and probably more frequently than most people, is driving through their local neighborhoods. Not point A to point B driving like most normal people do, more like meandering drives along residential streets, randomly turning down one street and up the next, checking the homes out as they go and taking notes of the long signs of other realtors as they mutter and curse. In a city the size of Barrie, if you don't know the person who lives in a house you see newly listed, chances are you know someone else who does know them. If only everyone I know encouraged every other person they know who was about to sell or buy a home to call me, I'm sure I could retire before 70. The reason good realtors like to take those seemingly aimless drives around our local neighborhoods is we want to keep ourselves up to date and in the know about the status and the activity in the neighborhoods we work in. One thing that crosses my mind when I'm out driving around, I wonder if people are genuinely happy and content, and do their homes meet up with their current needs? More than 60% of current homeowners over 50 with no children living with them live in homes that are beyond their current living needs and utilize not more than 30% of the living space on a regular basis. Keep in mind, we also have a deficit in Ontario of available housing suited to new and growing families looking to buy a first family home. Purely from an investment or financial management perspective, right now, with today's real estate market being as it is, it's an ideal time to downsize a home. Values have hit all-time highs in Central and South Central Ontario, and if you own a home anywhere in the Toronto region, there's a better chance than not that it's worth seven figures in 2021. In all likelihood, the frenzied real estate market we've been seeing for much of the past 2 years is going to level off. My expectations are this will happen at some point this year, and when it does, the bidding wars will stop, and listings that have been selling in a couple days will start to take a little longer to attract buyers, and it could be sometime before the market starts to push prices upwards again. As more and more of us receive our COVID-19 vaccinations, the concerns over catching the virus will quickly begin to fade. Those, and I suspect there are many of them, who have held off on listing their homes for over the past year and a half, they will begin putting their properties onto the market, and when they do, inventory levels of homes for sale are likely going to rise and will equal or quite likely outnumber the buyers who will still be actively looking for homes to buy. And that shift will be the first one offering some leverage to buyers over sellers that we've seen in quite a few years. But taking advantage of market dynamics and strategy all on its own aren't enough to motivate most people into selling their homes, particularly longtime owners. Selling one's home can be a truly emotional experience, especially if you have an accumulation of memories attached to that home. It is also a daunting task, more of a series of daunting tasks, to prepare a home to sell, to then find your next place, to pack up, to purge your possessions, and then to finally transport and fit your life and your belongings into a new and unfamiliar space at a new address. Those things don't get easier in our latter years. There has to be significant and good practical reason for most of us to want to move, and especially to downsize our living accommodations. So what are the signs it may genuinely be a good time and also be your time to consider downsizing? For many still living in a home that they raised their family in, the criteria you used to select and purchase that family home were first and foremost centered on finding something that would meet the needs and wants of a growing family and serve a more active lifestyle. Proximity to schools, playgrounds, walkable neighborhoods, ample parking, a rec room, and generous yard are some of the things younger families starting out look for in a new home that hold little or less relevance to empty nesters. Once the kids have left the nest and needs and priorities evolve as they do, the stress involved with maintaining a full-size family home can begin to rival the comfort levels it still brings. The cost of carrying and maintaining an aging home is a primary stress point for some, especially when we hit retirement and are living on fixed incomes. A good exercise to undertake is to determine what percentage of your monthly income is going to mortgage, utilities, property insurance, taxes, and maintenance of your home. Make a separate list of the components of the home that are at or near the end of their useful life cycles. roofing, windows, furnaces and air systems, pools in their systems, driveways, all of these things have a lifespan and significant replacement costs. Replacing any of them costs more than can typically be recovered when you go to sell. Add them all up. If those costs exceed 30% of what you take in each month, then this would be one good reason to consider downsizing your home to something that leaves you with more money for your own personal enjoyment, your retirement plans, as well as any unplanned expenses that may lay ahead. Another consideration is how much of your home are you paying to heat in the winter, cool in the summer, paying property taxes on, but you rarely, if ever, use anymore. Spare bedrooms, dining rooms, home offices, extra baths, rec rooms, tool rooms, storage rooms. These are all accesses if you're not using them. Retirement in 2021 no longer means watching Jeopardy every night and then going to the Golden Griddle a couple times a month. Seniors, if we're even able to call them seniors anymore, have different lifestyles than their aging parents did. This is the Woodstock generation, now entering their golden years. And for the most part, they are far more active than their parents were in their latter years. They're at the gym, yoga, they have hobbies and take classes, they hike, golf, ski, bike, and they go on regular vacations. Downsizing allows more freedom to do the things we want to do in retirement by freeing up equity and reducing monthly home costs and obligations. Keeping a home maintained, especially a home that is more than 20 years old, becomes a pain in the ass, as well as in the back, the legs, and the joints. I'm in my 50s, and I can attest to that. But certainly in my 60s and 70s, I don't want to be climbing ladders and cleaning gutters and shoveling 3 feet of snow from my double driveway. I don't want to spend my weekends cutting grass or raking and bagging leaves if I don't have to. I do them now out of necessity. My father loved doing these things and would while away the days with such projects. But as happened with him in his 70s, eventually we all hit that point where the tasks become just too much to handle and keep up with. When I am called to list a home with senior owners, often the home has begun to fade or become dated. The owners have often passed that point where they were able to keep up with the work. Unfortunately, the resale value of a home is increasingly impacted the longer the care and maintenance it needs is allowed to fall behind. Best to know when that point is and make moving decisions before things begin to deteriorate. Aging in place is one option that's becoming popular over downsizing, yet it does require some honest and open assessment to determine if it makes financial and practical sense to modify your home to accommodate any future mobility issues that may be faced. Two-story homes are less practical than bungalows. Stairs inside of a home and at the entrance become safety hazards. Lifts, ramps, and safety rails can help to reduce safety risks. Other modifications can include upgraded lighting, covering slippery hardwood floor surfaces with carpeting. Another consideration with aging in place is that at some point, most are going to need assistance in the home. Healthcare, cleaning, laundry, meal preparation, shopping, and transportation when one is no longer able to drive. And these all come with an added cost. The layout of the home in and of itself may not be conducive for safe living, and the landscaping, narrow hallways, again stairways, walkways, and outside stairs prone to ice in the winter. In the end, it may be more practical and certainly less expensive to find another place already set up with fewer obstacles and safety risks to contend with. Okay, now let's shift this conversation to some more positive and optimistic discussion. If you have been in your home for more than 5 years, it's more than likely doubled in value. 20 years or more, and it has increased 4 times or more in all likelihood. $1 million home in the GTA today was worth $100,000 to $150,000 in the 90s. I'm talking about home equity here. We can see it in our mortgage statements. It's there and it's ours, but it is not money that is readily accessible when it's attached to a home. It can be borrowed against in the form of a line of credit or a reverse mortgage, which is effectively paying monthly interest payments and fees to borrow from an asset that is already yours. Retirement doesn't have to tie us down to one location. Quite the opposite, in fact. This is the time of life you get to choose where to live, and for the reasons that serve you or you and your partner alone, you can move closer to family, pursue warmer climates, move back into town where everything is conveniently minutes away and there are multiple transportation choices available. It's all up to you. Maybe the goal will be to find something with one half or one third the monthly cash outlay of your current home and take that sales equity that you'll have and start crossing off some travel destinations off your bucket list. Consider as well that, unlike any previous moves, planning for new or future needs is more important than ever. Consider such things as likelihood of needing caregiver assistance, mobility considerations, location and proximity to medical care and grocery shopping, your budget that you wish to work within. These will all play a role in the type of place that you'll be searching for. So what are the options and the alternatives out there? I've listed a few. First is the single-story home or condo. Not much more than 1,200 square feet with one or two bedrooms is going to be enough space for one or two people to live comfortably and without too much work or maintenance. Your age and financial situation and whether you want the equity from your sale of your existing home to go more towards a home purchase or towards your retirement lifestyle plans will help to determine if renting or buying is the better option for you. Access to in-home care and assistance may also play into that choice. Moving in with family, being close to children and grandchildren can enhance the bond you have. The other side of that same coin is if you have parents who are now or soon to be in need of assistance, the peace of mind from blending the family with aging parents alone makes this an option worthy of proper consideration and discussion. Just be gentle on how you approach it with your parents and parents on how you approach it with your children. Like any relationship, business or social, it is best to ease in with eyes wide open and with a clear understanding and respect of each other's boundaries, expectations, and responsibilities. Another option within the bounds of multi-generational living that may satisfy all safety needs and concerns while at the same time providing a solution that parents and offspring alike can get excited about is for both parties to sell their existing homes, then apply the spoils towards a new home that checks all the boxes of what a shared home should and could have. Safety, space, and layout that offers privacy when wanted yet has shared space that everyone can enjoy. Another option still is to move into an independent adult living community. I've been toured through most of the ones that exist in the Barrie area, and some of them feel like being in the Hilton Hotel or on a cruise ship. My stereotype image of seniors living facilities was totally shattered when I was running for city council a few years back, and I would visit with residents and do campaign presentations in their various homes in Barrie. They typically provide and prepare meals, transportation, housekeeping or maintenance and health-related services. There are recreational centers and events and groups activities to participate in if one chooses. Opportunity to connect with others. You're surrounded by like-minded neighbors with interests common with your own, and for many, this is an enjoyable way to live out those twilight years. For those who need some assistance with daily tasks or have physical or mental health limitations that require ongoing attention, then a fully assisted living community makes the most practical sense. Seniors who can live somewhat independently but require assistance for some daily tasks are a good match for assisted living. Typically, the staff is available 24 hours a day, and meal prep, medication management, bathing, dressing, housekeeping, and transportation are all services that are available. They also offer social groups and recreation and rehab activities. In-home care services are also offered at various levels depending on the situation. In-home caregivers can provide help with day-to-day activities like cooking, grooming, or shopping, while also making sure you are safe in your home. There are many factors to take into account in deciding if now is the right time to downsize and just what will I be downsizing to. It's a tough decision for many to confront, and often it is a good idea to involve family or trusted friends who can offer some objective perspective when working through the decisions on when and what to do next. If a home purchase or sale is in your future, if you or someone close to you is pondering the pros and cons of downsizing, and if you wish to count me among the realtors to be interviewed for the job of representing you and stepping you through the daunting process with the least amount of friction, then give me a call or text me at 705-718-6119. Before you do, you might want to check out the services I provide to my clients. Visit the website whomovesyou.ca for a bit more information. And when it comes to showcasing your home for sale or enabling buyers to search for and research properties that are for sale, I would challenge you to find a better local site than whomovesyou.ca. Oh, and one last thing that won't hurt a bit. Hit the subscribe button to cement our friendship and be sure to find future episodes of the podcast waiting for you the next time you open your podcast player. I'm Mike Montague. Thanks for listening to Who Moves You.